So welcome everyone. Thanks a lot for joining us for yet another edition of these Metaflow Office Hours. We have Tom Fursten today from Delivery Hero, sorry, Deliveroo, who's going to talk to us about their use of Metaflow and how Metaflow combined with Kubernetes and Argo is actually used in their setup. And Tom has a very I just saw your LinkedIn profile, and it's actually really impressive. You have a PhD in machine learning, and then lots of different experiences as data scientists, starting off kind of sort of in early stages, and then becoming going on to become the lead data scientist. So this is really impressive. Thanks a lot, Tom, for joining us, and thanks a lot for doing this talk and sharing your experiences with us. Over to you.
Cool. Thank you very much for having me. Let me share my screen. People can see my screen, okay?
Yes.
Okay, great, awesome. So, as was mentioned, I work at Deliveroo. So, I'm going to be talking about, I mean, we just deployed Metaflow earlier this year, probably around April. We started doing piloting it for production use cases, and we're now at the moment rolling out to all of our ML teams. I wanted to talk about a particular part of our deployment that I thought might be of interest, which is how we actually deploy our pipelines, our Metaflow pipelines in staging and production. So not local remote development, just once people are happy, how they deploy it, and in particular our approach to using GitOps for doing that. So that's kind of the focus of the talk. Yeah, quick
Just quick,
introduction.
sorry, quick point. Can you maybe have your mic a little closer or your laptop a little closer, maybe? Just
You can hear me now?
yeah, this is better. This is much, much better.
Okay,
Sorry, go
cool.
ahead.
Cool. No
Go
worries.
ahead.
I'm English and I tend to mumble, so
No. It was the more of the volume.
yeah, no worries, no worries. If it goes a bit low, then just prod me and I'll start to shout.
Sure. Yeah. No, this is
Okay.
great.
Cool. So yeah, Deliveroo is not in the US, but for those who haven't heard of the company, it was founded in 2013, then went public 2021. It is kind of, well, I started out as a food delivery company. So, restaurants want to deliver food to customers, and customers don't want to have to travel to the restaurant to go pick it up. And so Deliveroo kind of filled that gap in the UK market, a bit like, I guess, Uber Eats or I think DoorDash. I forget the other. But that kind of thing. So that's to give you some context. And I've been at the company for 2 years. It'll actually be 2 years tomorrow. Yeah, I work on the ML platform team. There was no, like, I was the first member on the team. We have some people who've been at the company longer or who were on different teams at the time, but that was when the actual team properly started. And we basically serve roughly 16 teams, so about 45 MLEs. So for all of their ML life cycle. So the tech stack when I started, I'm going to focus on the model training side of things and model development, not talk about model serving at all, which is relevant for Metaflow, I guess. But when I started, we had kind of a legacy orchestration engine, actually an in-house one. That we wanted to remove. Just saying that as part of the context, not really super relevant to the talk. And another part of the problem that we wanted to solve is actually people could deploy their pipelines in various different ways. So some people could do it through, like people could do it for code, but actually other people found that they could do it through UI. And they would have a tendency to do that as well. And it kind of led to a confusing situation where even the teams themselves didn't really know what was deployed, which is obviously not an ideal situation. And that was one of the core things that decided we need to kind of get that sorted. Everyone should know what's deployed at any given time. And at the same time, we want it to be auditable, and someone shouldn't just be able to go off and click and delete a pipeline, deployed production pipeline. There should be kind of an audited, trackable process for doing that. And we want it to be secure. So that's the emphasis of the talk. I'll touch on things as well as we go, but let's keep that in mind as we go along. Yeah, so while we're kind of researching different potential options, one thing that we did look at, especially in terms of deployment, was GitOps. So just kind of ELI5 for those who've not heard of GitOps before. Basically, the idea is that you have a Git repository that is going to be your source of truth. So that Git repository is going to contain a load of declarative configuration files. And that's basically what you want to have deployed in a particular environment at any time. And then you have an automation tool that basically watches that repo, particular branch of that repo, or a particular folder in that repo. And if it notices a change, it will pull that from the repo and deploy it to the cluster. And then, if you want to make a new deployment, you basically just update that Git repo. You don't do it manually, that'll be part of some CI/CD process that will update it for you. Go into a bit more detail on how we do it in a bit. But going back to the aim of wanting to have an auditable, kind of clear single version of truth of what's deployed, you can see this pretty much automatically save, solves that because if we want to see what pipelines deployed at any time, you go to a deployment repo and you can see exactly which teams deployed what. And also if someone wants to deploy, it's completely controlled by Git. So, if deployments are done via the main branch, for example, you can lock that down so that you require reviews, so people can't just go off and delete stuff or whatever. So that's like.
Quick question here. So was the goal here to do GitOps just for the training side of things, which were kind of pipelines, or was it also GitOps for model serving? And what kind of model serving was there? Like, was it real time? Was it also another batch of?
I wasn't really going to touch model serving. It's kind of we are working on model serving at the time. We are not taking a model like the approach we've taken, given the tech stack that we have. I don't think there was really a readily available GitOps process for that.
Got it.
Because we're using Kubernetes for model training, that's definitely kind of available.
Got
Cool. That answer your question?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
Okay.
this.
If anyone's interested and they don't know much about GitOps, so that this site is quite good. I think it's a good overview of the benefits of the approach. Okay, cool. So yeah, the initial solution. Oh, I should have said. Before I go on to Mesflow, I'm going to talk a bit about the journey of how we've got to Mesflow. Said I've been here 2 years at Deliveroo, and we deployed Mesflow early in the year. Obviously, that leaves about a year and a half gap. We did actually do some work in that time. I want to lay the groundwork of how we got to where we are. So I'm going to talk about what we deployed first, kind of briefly and on the high level, and then hopefully it will provide some context of how we came up with the solution of how we deploy pipelines, Mesflow pipelines. So yeah. Anyway, so yeah, the first thing that we actually decided was to get rid of the old legacy orchestration engine and go with Argo workflows. Basically, this is kind of a Kubernetes orchestration engine. It's all YAML files, all declarative YAML files. And yeah, for those who haven't used it, it's super powerful, extremely versatile. Gets complicated as you want to do more complicated things, but yeah, it's a really cool and powerful tool. But for those who haven't seen it, you end up basically with these types of YAML files that define your pipeline. This is a workflow, but you also have workflow templates and cron workflows. And basically, you can define your steps and the Docker containers you want to run and the commands you want to run, and so on and so forth. So we picked that as our orchestration engine. And then, as our deployment process, we went for GitOps process. And basically, we rely on a tool called Argo CD. And as I mentioned, this is basically a tool that watches Git repos. So you configure it to watch, which repo you want to watch and which branch and which folder. And then it will sync that to the corresponding namespace, Kubernetes namespace. And basically, because everything's declarative in Argo workflows, it does also declarative definitions and deploys into the cluster. So that's the approach we've taken. And then we actually have two related approaches for how people can deploy, and they serve different purposes. So we have branch-based deployments. So MLE merges a branch into either staging or main, and then the CI/CD process kicks off and builds a Docker image or Docker images, populates the manifest file with information that's specific to that environment and that deployment, and then writes it to a second repository, which is a deployment repository. No one actually touches that in person. It's all automated. You'd never actually touch that repo. And then Argo CD is basically sat there watching that. And then when it sees a change, in the way we've structured it, when it sees a change in a folder on a particular branch, it will then pull that and deploy it to the cluster, staging for staging and then main for production. So that's how it works. So it's all very clear, and it's a great thing to be able to just like have all the teams in one place and see who's deployed what. It's like super helpful as a platform team to be able to do that. And then after we did that, we introduced the second idea, which was basically we called it experiment pipelines. I'm introducing it because actually we're going to integrate this functionality of Metaflow as well. So I'm talking about it for a reason, but it serves additional purposes. So one thing with the branch-based deployment is it's kind of hard for people. If you have a busy repo, model repo, and a lot of people want to test stuff out, you're having a lot of people to merge into staging just to test stuff. And so actually we want to be able to provide the opportunity for people to test outside of merging straight into staging or main. and then also long-running tests, so you want an A-B test. So you want to keep your experiment code separated from your main branch for throughout the course of the test. And the natural way of doing that is to keep it in a separate Git branch. So what we do with that is actually we've set up what we call experiment pipelines, where you just do a comment in your PR saying deploy to and then the environment. And then underneath the hood, it will run all the same stuff that on the previous slide. It will just deploy it to a different subfolder. And we have some manual steps to ensure that all the manifests are different, different names, so there's no collision. But essentially, it's the same. It's just a bit more flexible and serves some different use cases. It's clear?
This is super awesome because it's also kind of sort of one of the things that, you know, people talk about or aspire to do, that, you know, the goal is to kind of sort of have these automated CI/CD systems, even for pipelines or flows. Question here about like, what does the testing involve? Like when you create when a data scientist writes a flow, excuse me, and let's say, you know, they check it into the Git repository. I'm guessing like the sequence of events, like something is going to create the Argo workflow first, check it into the repository again. Mm-hmm. That Argo workflow is then the testing pipeline actually kicks in. What tests run on this pipeline? Is it more like unit tests or does it actually run
it's the more flow like an again? Yeah, it's more like an end-to-end test. So the MLE can go on to Argo and see the test pipeline and then run it and, you know, validate everything's running. Obviously, they have their unit tests and stuff as well.
Yeah.
We don't have like automated tests for the pipelines themselves, not on the Argo level. I know you can do that with Metaflow quite easily, but on the Argo level, like if you want to test the pipeline end to end, you kind of deploy it via an experiment pipeline. So you have your PR, you deploy it that way. Once it's deployed, you'll get a notification once it's deployed. You would then go and, you know, run it, make sure, check the outputs and make sure you're happy with it.
So is the sequence of events like I create the PR, I add a comment which says deploy to sandbox. So mm-hmm. now it gets deployed in sandbox. I go to the sandbox, I click a button, trigger the workflow, run it, see that it works correctly and all that. And let's mm-hmm. say it works successfully. Then I come back to the PR and then I say deploy to production. So now deployed to production.
Yeah, yeah, if you want to, or you could merge the PR and it will get deployed to production that way as well. So yeah, deployed to production would be more like if you've got like an A/B test and you want to run both at the same time, then you would do that. If you just test the pipeline end-to-end as just like an end-to-end test, you'd probably do deploy to staging. Sandbox is just for our platform team, actually. It's just for us to test infrastructure, but
The comment for like using GitHub comments for actually deploying is actually pretty cool because then it kind of gives the flexibility. Sometimes the PRs are going to be very simple, like, oh, I just like, you know, fixed a typo. I don't want to deploy and go through the whole thing. So all automated tests can result just in a bit of spam. And on the other side, like you, so you may not want to deploy to sandbox in those cases, but in some other cases, you actually want to. So this is pretty cool.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's quite nice actually. I use this functionality a lot when I'm testing stuff out. So, cool. Yeah, obviously our teams are not called A, B, D, E, and F. But just to give you kind of an understanding, by the way, they don't all have to be in the same repo. That's just the way we've done it. But now, as a team, if we want to see what's deployed where, we can literally just go to our deployment repo and see which teams have deployed what. Not only can you see it, but it's actually a super rich source of information that you can build other tooling on top of. So anyway, that's before we went to deploy Metaflow. That's where we were as a platform team. We have all teams using it now. Legacy system is long gone, and you know it's been a big success for the company. But now, basically, what's the next stage? And kind of V2. Obviously, I'm still focusing on the model training. We are doing model serving stuff, but it's out of context for this talk, really. But on the model training kind of environment, so for development and productionization of the pipelines, kind of V2, we made the decision to introduce Metaflow, and that was basically going to sit alongside Argo workflows. Obviously, I'm preaching to the choir here, but in terms of Metaflow being a good tool. But just to give you some context why we did it, whilst Argo is kind of super versatile, it is quite complicated. And for IMLEs to kind of wrap their head around it sometimes it is a little bit too much. And kind of want to ease that pain. Also, by itself, it's kind of primarily a production tool. I personally wouldn't want to use it as a model development tool by itself because you know you'd have to rebuild your image and then push it and then writing the YAMLs themselves just for model development too much. And then you know the development production development loop is basically also a big problem. And then the like programmatic access to historic pipelines. You know, I'm talking to Metaflow, so obviously you know all these things. So I'll just skip to the next slide, but as a company or as a platform, these are the reasons we decided, you know, Metaflow is going to kind of hopefully close the loop and allow us to quickly iterate on pipelines locally and then deploy them and like run them remotely on staging just with our local code. And then once we're ready, we want to be able to deploy them. And then once we want to iterate, we can just, you know, cut a branch and carry on. Anyway, so we made that decision to kind of use Metaflow in conjunction with Argo workflows. A couple of things that we wanted to do, given where we were, and this is why I gave the historical context of how we got to where we are at the moment. We wanted very much to maintain our GitOps deployment process. GitOps is a very powerful framework. It's super simple, and it's something that we definitely wanted to keep. And then kind of tangential, but kind of added it just to add some context on the solution that we finalized on. We actually wanted all our remote development pipelines and our staging production pipelines to run in Argo workflows. I don't want to dwell on it too much because it's not the main focus, but we didn't really want to use jobs, Kubernetes jobs for our development flows. So that's something that we also did. Cool.
Can you add
Yeah.
some, sorry, can you add some color about that? Like, why were Kubernetes jobs not considered like good enough?
I mean, we've done a lot of work on Argo workflows to kind of on the
I
monitoring
see.
and logging and all of that sort of stuff, and adding an extra way of running stuff on Kubernetes is just going to add
Okay.
extra work for us as a platform
Sure.
team, and
Sure.
also, yeah, extra mental load on the MLEs as well. You'd rather just have one guy doing it.
Got it.
And you know, Argo is kind of a super powerful tool on our side. It consists of two commands. It's submit, which is basically used to run development pipeline runs remotely, and then create, which is just used to create the manifest files. And then, like, that's it. We don't have anything else in that command. So, this submit command basically just generates the Metaflow manifest just like normal. And then we use the extensions to kind of do various things. For development, we just remove any kind of production configuration, so production token or anything that kind of marks it as a Metaflow pipeline. And then, so I can to me. And then we convert it from a workflow template to a workflow, and then submit the workflow to the cluster, staging cluster. No one has access to production cluster. And then just to clarify the third point, we changed it to a workflow just because we have a centrally managed TTLs. So basically, anything done through the submit command will be automatically cleaned up. So everything that actually persists on the cluster is done through GitOps. So that's the reason why we did that. If you want to submit a template or a cron workflow, you have to do it through your Git repo. And then we have the create command. Very similar, we generate the Metaflow pipeline, the Argo manifest through Metaflow in the standard way. And then we use extensions to do any updates that we want to do. I just kind of give you a context of some of the things that we do. For example, environment variables from secrets like vanilla Metaflow will load the secret into an environment variable that follows the key in the Kubernetes secret. We actually felt this wasn't like flexible enough, and we'd actually want to specify which environment variable it's loaded into. So things like that, because we just felt that was more flexible for us. Anyway, and then we write the workflow template to a file. And then optionally, if we are scheduling that workflow on a regular basis, we'll also write the cron workflow. And then we've just integrated that into our existing deployment process. So just here. So basically, we just have teams provide a configuration file of which flows within their repo they want to schedule, and then provide some extra configuration. And then we use that within the CI/CD process to generate these files. Basically, using the Argo workflows create command, generate all these files and then write them to deployment repo. And then the rest is just like normal, right? So that gets picked up by Argo CD and deployed to the cluster. And then we integrated the pipelines with Metaflow branches. So the standard production pipeline process, the branch deployment, the main branch that will correspond to your production branch Metaflow. In terms of the actual YAML file, it just be prod helloflow.yaml. And then with the Metaflow branches, so if someone deploys through an experiment pipeline, we basically automatically assign a branch that corresponds to the PR number for that repo. And then it's test the branch name. So it's all automatically segregated, which I thought was quite nice. Previously, before the experiment pipelines, we had to have a manual step to make sure that everything was kept separated in terms of the other workflow resources. So actually, Metaflow's kind of solved that problem for us. And then the final bit is just production token. I know it's kind of the original intention was for this to be kind of because you have a CLI-based deployment process to stop kind of fat fingering, if that's the correct term. Obviously, we have a Git deployment process, so we don't have that issue. So we wanted to make use of it anyway, so we actually just set it to the Git commit hash. So it's not to stop people deploying. In our case, we actually just use it so people can search for their deployments by their commit hash if they want to.
So every hash becomes a tag on Metaflow, so you can
Exactly, yeah.
nice, very cool.
Yeah, that's it pretty much. Future steps. We're still rolling out Metaflow. We have a couple of teams, like the teams that we did the pilots with early in the year. But the main team that we did was like super happy, and pretty much using it for all their pipelines now. And now with the rest of the teams, we're kind of rolling it out. So we're doing picking up pipeline by pipeline. Obviously, they have business stuff to do as well, but we are rolling out on Angers as we speak. So far so good. It's a great tool, by the way. I'm like as a someone from a machine learning background who went to private sector, Metaflow is completely aligned with how I personally would like to develop models and then productionize them. So I think kudos. I think you're doing a great job. Also, just like to say that Metaflow extensions, I think, is also really, really cool and great. And it's done a lot of the heavy lifting for us. So Would be, I know it's not officially supported, but yeah, kind of on my wish list. It would be great if at some point in the future it kind of became an official supported part of
Yeah.
Metaflow. And then the other thing, I know by doing pipeline runs on Argo and not like as Kubernetes jobs, we have lost a few things. One is we can't do some steps locally and some remotely. Not really bothered by that personally. I'd like to just either run it all locally or remotely. So kind of happy with that decision not to bother with that sort of thing. But one thing that we can't do at the moment is do the resume command on remote runs because it's like, not integrated with Metaflow. So yeah, I don't know if we might be able to do this for extensions or not, but would be interested, like just talk about me personal level. See if it can be used with something like step memorization, which is a good functionality that kind of allows you to skip steps. But yeah, that'd be quite fun. Yeah, that's it for me.